important for Chinese firms, but also for other developing countries. So we find that, say, since 2000, if we look at the total export from all developing countries, approximately 18% of them is conducted under this regime, processing trade regime. And in China, in fact, processing trade over time, the proportion is declining. However, even if it is declining, so previously it was very high, even more than 70%, but now it's still around the one half, 50%, 48%, around that number. So processing trade is extremely important for firms in developing countries if they want to participate in the global value chain, and particularly important for Chinese firms. However, very little is known about the firm's performance, especially when they are conducting processing trade, whether it is related with their productivity and some other characteristics of their performance. This is because sometimes we do have the difficulty in obtaining the appropriate data to measure the productivity for the firms. Later on, I will talk about why we say the data availability is not so easy, because all the previous studies that they are finding are based on some standard revenue-based productivity measures. Okay, so now I want to point out there is a very famous puzzle in the trade literature. It is called negative export premium in China. So previously, people don't think this is a puzzle because in all countries, in other countries' data, we find that empirical evidence is consistent with theory, which is exporters should be more productive than non-exporters. But later on, we have some studies using Chinese data. They uncover the opposite pattern. For example, some paper find, which is in the literature that I will show, they report a negative export premium, which is they show that in China, exporting firms are less productive than non-exporting firms. Now, this is difficult to explain. Shall we believe the domestic market is even have tougher competition than foreign market? So if you enter the domestic market, you incur even higher fixed cost than entering foreign market. Or later on, some people have follow-up studies, and they try to explain why there is a negative export premium. Then they say, okay, because processing trade firms play a role. Then they say, if you are able to control for the trade mode, whether this exporting firm is conducting processing trade or ordinary trade, then they find, okay, there is no difference. If you are able to control for the processing trade and ordinary trade, different trade mode. So in this project, we try to answer this question from a different perspective. We want to look at especially whether or not all the previous findings, whether or not they have some fundamental measurement issues when they talk about productivity. This is because in all the previous findings, when they say exporters are less productive than non-exporters, they report a revenue-based productivity. But this is not a true measure for productivity. Later on, I will explain in more detail. So in this project, we will investigate in particular, we will compare different measures of productivity, which is revenue-based and quantity-based productivity. And later on, we find that indeed, if we are able to properly estimate a firm true productivity, exporting firms are still more productive than non-exporting firms. But why do the previous studies find a negative export premium? This is because of the pricing heterogeneity, which is we find that exporting firms, they have a different pricing scheme when they sell to the foreign market compared to the non-exporting firms. Then later we will further decompose this one into different types of exporting firms. Okay? So especially we will focus on this type of processing trade firms. So what we do in this paper is we first try to investigate whether or not the firm's productivity is related with their participation in the global value chain. firm level productivity measures, and we will compare revenue-based productivity and physical quantity-based productivity. Then we will provide evidence that there is a very large bias towards firms engaged in processing trade. So, which means if a firm is conducting other types of trade, non-processing trade firms, they do not show significant difference in terms of pricing heterogeneity and also in terms of the productivity difference that we can see the detailed evidence. So the processing trade firms are very special. They will have very different pricing scheme that this will be reflected in their final revenue. So when you use revenue-based productivity, you will find a negative exporter premium. So we show that exporters still more effective and productive if we look at physical productivity. But they do not necessarily have higher revenue productivity. So if you look at revenue productivity, you may find a negative exporter premium. And also we find that exporters will charge significantly lower when they sell to the foreign market. Then those effects are mostly driven by processing trade firms. So this suggests to us it is very important when we talk about a firm's performance and productivity, all of those issues should be related with the types of trade transactions, under which regime you are conducting trade. That's why it's important. So China is very special because China particularly encouraged this type of trade we call processing trade. Now let me explain what is processing trade. So processing trade is there are also different types of processing trade. One is called processing with assembly. The other is processing using imported inputs. So for the processing with assembling, the firms conducting a processing trade is able to receive the inputs or components of final product for free from purchasing partner. Usually those firms are under foreign investment. So they are a lot of foreign company coming to Chinese market, they will build a plant that let those affiliated firms conducting processing trade. Then they will send the components to their affiliated firms. Then the affiliated firm is doing sampling work, have the final product, and then re-export to the global market. Then the second type is called processing with imported inputs. This type of processing trade firms, they also need to do assembling work. But the difference with the first type is they need to pay for their imported inputs. They do not get the inputs for free. Okay. So, but anyhow, as long as you are under processing trade firms, you have some policy treatment, a favorable policy towards processing trade is you don't have to pay tariff. If you are conducting your own trade, which is the counterpart compared to processing trade, we call ordinary trade. Ordinary trade, literally speaking, should be a normal trade mode, right? It's a typical trade firms. As a typical trade firms, you should buy imported inputs by paying tariff. Then you will do some value added work, you have your final product, you export. That is your ordinary trade. But processing trade firms, they don't have to pay tariff. This is because the country tried to encourage this type of trade, processing trade. This is not only the special practice of China, even under other developing countries, they also use this, this policy. And there is another restriction towards processing trade firms. They have to sell their products all to the foreign market. They cannot sell in the domestic market. This is partially because of the government concern. They may worry about if those processing trade firms don't have to pay tariff, they already have a better policy compared with other domestic exporting firms, then if they sell to the domestic market, maybe will cause tougher competition and drive out the domestic firms. So now, when we observe different types of firms conducting trade, we say there is processing and ordinary. But sometimes in the customs data, we will observe a lot of firms is conducting both. We call hybrid firms. So the firms may be for some product she's under the processing trade regime, but for other products, she's under ordinary trade regime. Certainly, from firms' perspective, they want to claim them to be under processing trade regime because that can help them to get import tariff free. Okay? They don't have to pay tariff. Also, they have some other better policies about value-added tax. Later on, we'll talk about that. So those types of firms, they may have a very different level of physical efficiency or production efficiency when we try to estimate their productivity. So if we are talking about Chinese firms' productivity issues, we indeed should consider their different trade mode. And also, on the different trade mode, they price very differently. And the price is related with revenue productivity. In a few slides, we will see that. So what is the empirical strategy we conduct in this project? So we will employ a very new data set, which is also unique because we haven't seen the previous studies using such data. This is a firm product level production quantity database. So this database can tell us indeed how many units of the products this firm is producing. So we are able to more precisely to estimate the physical productivity with, for short we call TFPQ. Q represents quantity, based on the quantity. So if we recall our economics knowledge, when we write down this production function Y, actually this Y is represented the physical quantity. So estimate TFPQ for Chinese firms, then we will look at the different mode of trade regime and compare TFPQ with TFPR. Then we will find the potential bias in the productivity estimates. Then we will try to relate this difference between revenue-based productivity and quantity-based productivity to the output pricing differences. Before we talk about the detail, let me give you some literature review. So as we said, some previous studies find a negative exporter premium. Let's say the first paper report to this is a very important paper, still causing a lot of debate in the in this area. So this is Danlu's paper. She documented a negative premium for Chinese exporters. She find exporting firms are less productive. Certainly, she's using revenue-based productivity measure, and she didn't look at the custom data. She looked at the Chinese manufacturing survey data. That one has one variable to tell you whether this firm is exporter or non-exporter. Then later on, as I said, because this question is extremely important. Now, if China is indeed exceptional, that means that all the classic trade theory doesn't apply to Chinese firms, right? So we need to understand what is going on there. And this is a follow-up study by three authors together, 2016, published in Journal for Development Economics. The initial paper is still non-working paper, but it indeed introduced a very new question and caused the debate in the field. Now, this one, this published paper, associated this negative exporter premium to the role of processing trade. As I said, they find, okay, if we are able to control for the trade mode, then the exporter premium, the negative one, will become insignificant. Now, later on, we will see our results in part of will be consistent with them, but they still look at the revenue productivity. Now, we will say that if we are able to estimate physical productivity, then all the exporters are indeed still more productive than non-exporters, which is consistent with the trade theory. So we show that the previous results actually reflect the estimation bias in revenue productivity, but the bias is coming from the price difference. So our study is linked to a very large literature in the IO industrial organizations studies, which the people try to develop new methodology in estimating firm productivity. This is a large literature, and also related with the recent paper, especially using in other countries, they already have physical quantity data available, so they are able to estimate physical productivity to address different questions. Now, this is my co-authors, their 2013 GIE paper. It's also looking at physical productivity in Chile data.
So it's a different country's data, but for different questions. So this tells us actually in terms of the measurement, revenue productivity and physical productivity may reflect a very different picture. But if a country, let's say, in some developed countries, if there is no such a big price heterogeneity among exporting firm and non-exporting firm, then the both revenue productivity and physical productivity will move towards the same direction. But if so, it doesn't matter for those countries. So especially we find, usually if you find the physical productivity and the revenue productivity may have very different direction, usually it's in developing countries, such as when you look at Chile data. So here we will use Chinese data. Now let me explain production, productivity estimation, and the relationship with the pricing heterogeneity. Now, in order to estimate productivity, when you write down your production, you have Y in the left-hand side. Now this Y, how to represent this Y? In the data, usually people just use total sales, total output values. So this is what we call the revenue-based. If you use that one to estimate productivity, you will use revenue as a function of input. So revenue will represent your output Y in the left-hand side. But we understand revenue is to multiply both the price and quantity. So there are two parts, two components of your revenue. So if you do not see very large price buyers, then maybe it's okay. Then Q and R will move towards the same direction. But in some countries, in some situations, then they may have very different pricing scheme than this one. It's indeed important to decompose this Q from the R. So if firms price very differently, then estimating TFP using revenue-based measure, okay, will lead to this we call output price bias. Then, certainly, in the previous revenue-based productivity measure, they also tried to address this issue. Now, we cannot say people didn't realize this is an issue. They already realized that how to address this output price bias. They tried to look at the price index at the industry level, because it is very hard to get a firm-level price information. Right? This is usually confidential. So, anyhow, in the TFPR, so usually it's already a combination of the technical efficiency, which is the quantity, how much quantity you produce, and also reflect the demand factor, because how high you can price your product is related with demand. Then the solution proposed in the literature, the best solution is better you know quantity directly. So if you are able to use quantity for output instead of revenue, you are able to estimate what we call quantity-based TFP, we call TFPQ, sometimes we call physical productivity. Now, this is easy to implement for single product firms. Certainly, we understand if the firm only produces one product, then the revenue is all from that product, then you can easily it's very clear. But it is more complicated for the multi-product firms. That there are recent development in the methodology side try to tackle this problem. Now, let's continue our discussion of the productivity measurement and the pricing heterogeneity. Because not only on the output side you have to suffer the price buyers, but on the input side you also have input price buyers. Because when you look at the input, usually you will consider capital, labor, and material. What is your material? You don't know how many units of these components you use in the production. You only know the value of the material. And also for the capital, you use usually fixed asset, and that is also your revenue based. Now for the labor part, it's relatively easier, because usually for labor, we have both information on the wage bill, the total payment to the worker, also you know the employment, how many workers you employ. So when you estimate your productivity, you also have the input price buyers in your estimation. Then how to solve this issue? Then we need to do something. In the estimation, you have control function. You try to control for this input price. But how to try to control for input price? You need some proxy.
use very expensive inputs, certainly you have to price your final product at a high level. So output price and input price should be positively correlated. Then you can use the output price. The output price we may be able to get, but for input price it's difficult to get. So we can use both the output price together with the market share information in the control function as proxy for the input price. Then if we are able to correct both output price buyers and input price buyers, and also using the physical quantity of production, then we are able to estimate a better and a properly measurement of physical, we call physical productivity. Now, later on we will find that this problem is extremely serious, or more serious for firms involved under different trade regimes. Maybe we find that for ordinary trade firms, this issue is not so significant, but we will show you, especially for processing trade firms, then we'll have very serious bias in terms of the price bias in their revenue productivity estimates. Okay. Before I talk data, previously, it's the overview part of all the background of this project. Now, let's look at the data part. So first, we will use a widely used Chinese manufacturing firm survey data. This will give us the balance sheets of the firm. We have the accounting information of each firm between 2000 to 2006 from the National Bureau of Statistics of China. So this is a very credible database. Lots of scholars use that. It will tell us the sales. It will tell us the total sales of the firm, that is the revenue of this firm. We also know the material in value, capital, fixed asset, labor, both wage bill and employment, ownership structure, location, and many detailed information of the firm. Now, if we want to look at the firms under different trade regimes, certainly we will need the trade data. This is provided by the customs. And the Chinese customs will record the firm product transaction level, which we also know exporting destination, importing source country, at a very detailed product classification. This is HS 8-digit level. Then we can see that in the customs data, this data is also widely used because lots of previous study already use that. Now this transaction mode will differentiate firms into processing trade, ordinary trade, or a mix of the two, we call hybrid. Because those custom data is at the transaction level. Maybe for this transaction, they use processing trade for this product. But for another transaction, they will use ordinary trade for the other product. So it's very possible the firms is hybrid firms. Certainly, we can merge these two together. According to some information, there requires a matching exercise, but it is it can be done. And people already use the merged data. The new data we employ in this study is this one. We call firm product production data. This is less used by the previous studies. Okay? Same period as the NBSC, also provided by National Bureau of Statistics, which is very credible. Now, it will tell us for each product how many units they produce, that is the quantity they produce. Then this is a firm product survey for more than 800 most important products, because from NBS perspective, they don't want to survey all products, there are so many products. So they only survey the most important product in their belief. They think this is important product, they will survey. Then they call the main industrial product. Approximately, it gives us this number of manufacturing firms. Those are all above scale firms, which are large production firms, is contained here in the manufacturing survey data. The first data set and the third data set can be perfectly merged because this is also conducted by NBS that give you the corporate code for the firm. Now, as we said, the custom data is under different department, it's customs. So in China, usually you work on Chinese data, you often have this issue.
different survey is conducted by different departments. They have their different cooling system. So that gives us trouble. But this way is very good. So this is also conducted by NDS. So we can perfectly match them. Okay, let's continue. So what is the detailed information in this production? Yeah, in this firm product production data. They have a catalog for those they call main industrial product. Then those data are organized in a hierarchical way, which is they consider more specifically a series of products that can be matched relatively easier to custom data using HKUST. Now, in this paper, we will focus on some products which China have very clear competitive advantage in those products. Traditionally, also very export-intensive products, such as footwear. So we look at a very specific product, it is leather shoes. So this leather shoes product actually span over several HS four-digit category, which is from the customer data. It's already aggregated more broadly than HS8, even at the HS4 level. Also expand several HS4 level. Let's look at this more. This is the HS product code in the custom data. At the HS6 level, it's universally harmonized across all countries. It's international standard. So at the HS6 digit level. But China has her own HS8 digit level, and the US has her own HS10 digit level. So but if we look at the first six digits, it's all the same across all countries. Now here we look at the first four digits. So chapter 64 is for footwear. Then among this footwear, there are different footwear. So you can find that some footwear are leather shoes, some are not. So we need to pick up the specifically the leather shoes. Why we do so? This is because we want to do very precise productivity estimation using a more thing. Usually, if you conduct IO studies, you only focus on one industry, on one product. But usually, in our trade study, we sometimes look at the overall sample. So that other than leather shoes, we will also show you we do one by one. We focus on different products. Okay? So here, giving you one example of product code in that firm product production data. So they will tell you how much, you have suits or shirts. There are different products, and this is a different coding system, which is different from the industry code, also different from the customer code. Now, among the alcohol beverage, you have beer or wine, so there are different products. Okay. This gives you an impression about what kind of data you expect to see in the firm product production data. So they will tell you the product code and the units, how many units. Quantity you produce. This is for steel. Certainly for steel it's more complicated. You have lots of different types of steel. So that's why we work on one by one. It's a lot of work. So here our sampling strategy is we need to identify some product, satisfy those conditions. First, we want this product is reported consistently over the time during the sample period, say between 2000 and 2006. Because some products, maybe some very special type of steel, in the previous years, China didn't produce, but later on, they become able to produce. Then you will find that those products are not reported in all years. So we want them consistently reported in all years. Also, we want that in this product, the producers, most of them are single product firms. If there are multiple product firms, we have the way to address that. But it's more complicated. So our starting point is single product. And with very little carry along trade, this is very important because that means those firms are focusing on production on their own. So which means they export the products that they produce by themselves. If they are conducting carry along trade, we mean some firms are able to export the products, not produce by themselves. But produced maybe by other firms, but other firms ask her to help her to export. This is often happen in China. But this is not, is less likely to happen in the leather shoes industry. As we look at the data, we find that this product has very little carrier launch rate. And also, we want this is dominated by Chinese firms, not say foreign invested firms. But later on, we do control for the ownership. We have some foreign invested firms in this product. Okay. Certainly, we want this product is export oriented, which is an export intensive industry. Otherwise, there are very few exporting firms in this industry. There is no sense to look at exporter premium. Then, also, we want that this product has widely, the firms will widely use processing trade regime. Then currently, we focus on leather shoes. We will report the results based on leather shoes and shirts. But we're also conducting for other products. We do not report all of them. We just want to report representative ones. Then later, we compare with maybe some other type of products that do not satisfy all of those conditions, especially they are more focusing on domestic market. Then they show very different features, such as the beer is very localized product, and also rice is different. So you find that it is indeed important to look at them one by one, one product by one. Then we want to get a proxy price. The price is not so easy to get. In the customs data, we have the export price, which is a unit value price calculated by dividing export value for that product by quantity. But we want to know, because we need to compare exporter versus non-exporter. If for non-exporter, they don't have any information in the custom data. So we will use the quantity they produced by all the firms, and we know their revenue from the NBS, the manufacturing survey data. Then if this firm is a single product firm, certainly her revenue is based on that one product. Okay. Then we can use that revenue divided by the quantity she produced for that specific product as a proxy for the price, which is a unit value price. As long as if little revenue comes from other sources, as we said, you need a very little carrier on trade. Now, if she can sell some product not produced by herself, it will be in trouble. This is a good assumption for the leather shoes producer because more than 75% of firms only export shoes or parts of the shoe. More than 95% export shoes and part of the shoes. Part of the shoe still belong to that category. The previous 64, chapter 64. Also, 90% of firms are single product firms for the leather shoes. They only produce this product. Now we can match between the NBSC accounting data and also the custom data. In terms of this specific product producer, this matching rate is very high. It's around 83%. Okay. Now the sample for leather shoes producer. We will find that this is a highly export-oriented product. The number of firms is increasing over time, that the exporter percentage is very high, also slightly increasing from 77% to 87%. So this is a very export-oriented industry. And among the firms conducting trade, we can decompose to processing trade firms, ordinary trade firms, and high volume trade firms. If in terms of firm number, we can see the distribution of three types of firms. And you find that also we can look at their trade value. So in fact, we find that the processing trade in this industry is not a very high percentage. As we said, the average percentage for processing trade among total export is around 48%, around one half. But here, for this industry, it's not so heavily reliant on processing trade. But even so, later on, we will see that it is because of processing trade we observe the difference in their productivity measures. Now, we show the, here is a summary of the results. Later, we look at detailed table. Now, we show the production function estimation with deflated revenue, that gives you revenue-based productivity, And also we have the quantity of production. We can show you physical productivity. Then we can look at exporter premium for both measures. Then we try to link to the different trade regime. And also we conduct more additional exercises and those things. Now here, for the production function estimation, we actually in the paper we have more than these two methods because there are a lot of different methods in estimating productivity. We want to show the results is very robust. So anyhow, you have material, labor, and capital. Then first, before you look at those exporter premium, you need to estimate your production function to get the measures of productivity. Then you can use a different functional form of your production function, either called Douglas or Treadstock production function. Now here, you can conduct the simple one, it's OLS, certainly we understand. This one will have some bias. And also, the most recent methodological development in the literature is this is the locker, goofy nudge, handle wall, and Nina Pavlik T. Okay. So DLGKP actually is the four authors, not the five authors. But the locker, usually people will include both D and L. So their paper is 2016 econometrica paper, which is the most cutting edge methodology in estimating productivity by correcting both input bias and output bias. Then we can use both way for both revenue and the physical. Now once we get the measures of productivity, we will use the TFPR, that is revenue productivity, TFPQ is a physical productivity as dependent variable. So here, because I don't show the complete table, so only certainly there are some fixed effects and other things, but the variable of interest here is exporter, whether or not you are exporter. So the default category is non-exporter. If this firm is exporter, then that dummy is one, okay? Then you will see that you use TFPR and TFPQ, you get a completely opposite result. Because if you look at TFPR, it is significantly negative related with exporter status. That means compared to non-exporters, exporting firms are less productive, even you use this DLGKP method, okay? Less productive as long as you use revenue productivity. But once you use physical productivity, it will become significantly positive, even for the simple OLS. Yeah.
So suppose I say that, when you look at quantity, you did not actually control for quality, right? So that's a shortcut. That's a problem with the quantity thing, right? But if I look at revenue, it's actually arguably already controlled for quality. So it seems that the TFPR is in fact a more convincing estimate, in my opinion.
Okay, let me address your question from two ways. First, we don't want to criticize that TFPR is no use. Actually, TFPR combined both price effect and physical efficiency effect, so it is certainly a very useful measurement. Okay? But when we talk about productivity, we are talking about the technical efficiency. That refer to, or we could say, physical productivity is a better proxy for the technical efficiency. Quality is related with the demand factor. So the quality actually reflects in your price. If you have high quality goods, you sell at a higher price. Indeed, so as you said, if you have a better product, you maybe sell at a higher price, that will show up in your TFPR, revenue productivity. But that doesn't mean you are very efficient in producing this product at a larger quantity scale, so you should compare both. We do not mean this one, which one is a, okay?
Yeah, I can just elaborate more, right? Suppose I'm a exporting firm. Even though quantity wise, I it looks like I'm more productive, but I'm actually exporting lower quality goods. So suppose exporters actually producing lower quality products. So you, even though they may actually be able to produce more quantity, right? But they're lower quality. So then what you see is exactly what you reported, that in terms of revenue, look at revenue, because if I'm selling domestically, maybe I sell more higher quality. So that would be consistent with what you have seen there. But I wouldn't agree that the exporters are actually more productive because they're actually selling lower quality products.
No, I agree with you on the quality side. As we said, the quality, you also agree, quality will be reflected in the price. And in fact, the quality cannot be directly measured. Usually in the literature, we also estimate quality, which is also a residual, rely on how do we estimate quality. And also, we will show you that indeed, say, if exporter price differently, price lower, they may sell. Why they price lower? Maybe because they sell low quality goods, or maybe because other reason, contractual arrangement, or because of the demand factor reasons. Quality is just a part of the price effect. So which means a high quality, you should sell high price, conditional on other things.
Revenue is a summary measure of how capable you are. Revenue is a summary measure. So I suppose your revenue means actually value added. I think what you mean is value added, right?
Yeah, I agree with you that we should, when we talk about that, we should specify this is a revenue-based productivity. But when you talk about the productivity, now there is another measure, it's physical efficiency. We want to uncover the complete picture. We do not want to say in the previous study they only have data to look at the revenue productivity, but that combine the physical efficiency and price. So we are able to decompose into these two components.
Yeah, but you cannot just say because it's quantity-wise, it produces more quantity, that means that it's more productive. Because you have not controlled for quality. So suppose I'm a very high quality shoe producer, okay? My profit margin is very, very high, but I produce very small quantity per worker, but per worker, the value added is still very high, okay?
You do have other measures for the firm's performance, such as your profit margin, such as your markup, right? Also, your price, how well this firm is performing, depends on many, many different measures.
Yeah, but so revenue is a summary measure. Revenue is a summary measure. How good you are, how capable you are, is measured by the revenue side,
not
the quantity side.
Then if you believe more on TFDR than TFPQ, you don't know why exporting firms in China give you a negative export premium. If according to that, then we should say the previous study based on revenue productivity, they will say exporting firms are less productive than
non-exporting firms.
But it is not the true information. So we would say exporting firms are still more productive in terms of physical efficiency, in terms of producing quantity, but why they show lower revenue productivity? Because they charge a lower price. Then what is the fundamental reason behind the price?
The fundamental reason is comparative advantage. It's comparative advantage because China has comparative advantage in these kind of labor intensive goods. Mm-hmm. So the domestic market is actually more competitive. The foreign market is actually less competitive. Therefore, the exporters can be less productive, can be less efficient.
This is the one potential reason behind that. I agree with you,
right.
There are other reasons if you want to dig deeper into say why you have this lower price scheme among the exporters and non-exporters in this industry. And as I said, some other industries are very different from this type of product. We said this product is conventionally China has competitive advantage. I fully agree with you on that. But as I said, TFPQ give you physical efficiency. This is very clear. Then TFPR combine this physical efficiency together with the pricing scheme. And also, even they sell at a lower price, that doesn't mean the exported goods have a lower quality than the exporting.
But I'm saying that revenue is a summary measure of how capable you are. It's a summary measure.
Well, we could say that way, but I believe people want to see more complete picture by not knowing just the revenue, but you also want to know how high you can charge your product price, right?
Ultimately, how capable you are is judged by how much value, how much profit you're able to generate, not how much quantity.
Now, if we are talking about the profit, it's not just the revenue. You also need to look at, compare your price with your marginal cost, estimate markup, then to do further work on that.
Yeah, but you're already in the value added, right? Total factor productivity is already a value added measure.
Then, are you suggesting we should just look at the TFER?
I think TFER is a more credible measure in my opinion, because
okay.
The Q doesn't adjust for quality. So if you know,
we didn't condemn TFPQ represent a quality. Actually, we don't want it to reflect the quality, because as we said, the quality will be reflected in the demand factor. If you have high quality goods, you charge a high price. Now indeed, you charge a lower price. So quality is also needed to be rigorously estimated. And if you have better information about the quality, such as the French wine, their paper, they know the rating of the product, they know very detailed information about quality.
But then you cannot just use quantity, you cannot just use how much quantity you're able to produce to measure how productive you are.
You
can sell 1,000 very, very shady quality shoes, okay? But I sell I just sell 100, but I sell very high quality.
Edwin, I think we are not contradicting each other, because I want to show you both TFPR and TFPQ and the price. I didn't just show you TFPQ, right? So I didn't say we should just look at TFPQ rather than TFPR. But we are saying only looking at TFPR is not sufficient. We should look at a more complete picture by considering the physical efficiency and the price. So given the time constraint, I think we should move on and show you a little more results. So here, now if we are able to estimate, we regress this one on the exporter, TFPR, TFPQ and the price, we do find that this effect is significantly coming from the price side. As we said, what kind of firms are doing price heterogeneity issue? Yeah, you can compare ordinary trade, processing trade, and hybrid trade. The default category is non-exporter. Now, you will find that, okay, this difference between the TFPR and TFPQ, in fact, is more driven by the processing trade firms. Which means that if you are able to compare ordinary trade, because this one doesn't work, cannot show you the red, that pointer. So if you compare ordinary trade with non-exporter, because default is non-exporter, they do not price significantly different. Ordinary trade firms, when they sell to foreign market, they do not price differently compared with non-exporters. Also, hybrid trade firms didn't price significantly different. Then the significant difference in terms of the pricing scheme is coming from processing trade firms. And this also show up in the TFPQ. TFPQ, which is processing trade firms, show significant positive exporter premium for the TFPQ. Okay. But you see, if you look at physical productivity, hybrid trade firms are also not significantly different compared with the non-exporter. So we are suggesting that we should consider the reason behind this negative exporter premium based on revenue productivity. And what is the reason behind that? If we know the reason, we are able to propose the solution. So let's say, why the processing trade firms have to charge lower? It may be because of the contractual arrangement. They have very little bargaining power when they receive the order from their foreign trade partner. So before we talk about that, let's summarize the previous results here. So there is a systematic difference between the effect of modern trade on both measures. We do not just want to highlight one measure, but we want to show you the comparison between these two. We
find that this is give you a very different result if you are able to look at the TFPQ. Then using TFPR, processing trade is associated, while using TFPQ is associated with 15% productivity gain. So this is, we are talking about how do you define productivity. You define productivity based on revenue base or based on the quantity based physical efficiency. Then the pricing difference, we are explain this difference between these two effects. Then the processing trade have different types. So we want to further conduct that. So then later on we will have more exercises by splitting processing trade into pure assembling and processing with informed input. Okay. The result is largely driven by the pure assembling firms. And also in the production function estimation, we do find that the prime material for materials is much lower for the pure assembling firms compared with the processing with imported inputs firms. This is consistent with the in the reality, because in the reality, those pure assembling firms don't have to pay on their own. They can get the material, the imported inputs for free from their trading partner. Then the export price is correlated highly with the price proxy, which is because in our previous study, we look at the comprehensive price, that is the total revenue divided by the quantity you produce. But you may sell your product to foreign markets or sell to the domestic market if you are not a processing trade firms. As I mentioned, if you are processing trade firms, you are not allowed to sell to the domestic market. You have to export all your product to the foreign market. But if you are conducting hybrid or you are conducting ordinary trade, you can sell some of your product to foreign market, some of your product to the domestic market. So our price proxy give you the comprehensive one, then we can get a very detailed information on the export price from the customs data. Then we find that the export price are highly correlated with the, our previous price proxy. Now, the processing trade firms are more likely to be owned as, by foreign investor. There are different types of wholly owned or joint venture. So later on, we also control for ownership, and also we control for some special economic zones or the subsidies provided to the firm. Now we find that in terms of some processing trade zone, they do provide a very good policy towards those processing trade firms, or they receive the subsidy. All of those do not affect the result. So if we show you the different types of processing trade, then only the pure assembling show very significant effect in terms of TFPQ. That means, we mean that those processing trade firms could produce very efficiently. They can produce a large quantity. Then, but their price is significantly lower. But you see, the processing with imported inputs could still price higher than the non-exporting firms. And the TFPR, for the TFPR pure assembling firms, in terms of revenue productivity, they do not show significant difference compared with the non-exporting firms. Then we also do exercise product by product. So for the shares, we find the similar results. And also for some, as we said, export intensive goods, and also conventional China have compared advantage for those goods. Then we say firms' performance is affected by participating in the production fragmentation through which type of trade they are participating, such as the processing trade or ordinary trade or the hybrid. Then it is important to take into account the different types of trade regime when you are looking at their productivity measures. Then when you look at productivity measures, you should also compare TFPR and TFPQ by considering both revenue-based and also the physical efficiency-based. There are potential reasons. The one more question, which is the follow-up study should be why their price is significantly lower for those firms. The price is significantly lower. Is that because they don't have to pay tariff? Actually, we are conducting this exercise. We artificially create this tariff for each processing trade firm. If they have to pay tariff, what will happen in their, say, final price and in their final revenue productivity and physical productivity. We expected to see it is not because they don't have to pay tariff. But potentially because some other reasons, now if the firm is under foreign investment as an affiliated firm, they may have to consider transfer pricing issues that intentionally report a lower price for their product. Now, this is another issue, so we should, all of those potential reasons, we need to conduct a further study on that to answer the question why they have a different pricing scheme. They have different pricing scheme also related with two components, marginal cost and markup part. So you are able to estimate markup, then once you get markup, you can also get the implied marginal cost. You can compare marginal cost with the imported inputs. You have the data from customs. Then you can see, is that because those firms are using different inputs compared with the other firms, or because they have very different markup. We expect to see those firms, those processing trade firms have very low markup, very low profit margin, so they have very low price schedule. Yeah. Okay, we are a little out of the time. So let's finish now. If you are interested, you are welcome to stay and we can discuss more. Do we allow some time for questions? Yeah.
Because of the short time, let me just entertain one question. Yeah.
Okay.
Is there any questions? Okay. So so if there's no question, I have no more questions myself. So so thank you very much for a very very interesting presentation. Please don't mind my spontaneous question. I think it actually made the seminar more interesting.
To have some discussion.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.